Welcome. This brief presentation is one in a series of five designed to provide you with an overview of the noteworthy changes in the latest edition of the IT Infrastructure Library, the ITIL 2011 edition. The subject of this presentation is service transition. The information that follows is based upon the opinions of the author. Nothing in this presentation is intended to create, nor does it create, any enforceable rights, remedies, entitlement, or obligations. The author and publisher of this presentation reserves the right to change or suspend any or all parts of this presentation. Thank you for your interest. Service transition highlights. The service transition publication has undergone a minor contextual edit. As in all the core publications, a comprehensive statement of the purpose and set of goals is included in the introduction, having been improved and moved from its previous location at the start of the principles chapter. Every diagram has been given extra treatment to ensure improved readability, and additional comprehensive guidance is provided on the concept of a change model, and new guidance on change proposals. A new diagram, previously seen in an introductory companion publication, is introduced to better explain the phases of release and deployment. What was named evaluation as a process in version 3 is now named the change evaluation process. And there is important clarification and additional guidance for how the change management process operates. New guidance is included to describe and differentiate asset and fixed asset management from service asset and configuration management. There is also new guidance on implementing service transition in a virtual or cloud environment, and a substantial explanation of risk, risk management, and the Cabinet Office's own management of risk, as well as the Information Systems Audit and Control Association's risk IT frameworks. Another important addition is a detailed table describing the inputs to and outputs from the service transition stage. There are about 37 additional pages. As in every core publication, a significant factor is the increased font size used for easier reading and the resizing of some figures and their placement to improve presentation and readability. There is no significant change in the number of figures and tables in service transition, and many have only minor changes to synchronize some of their titling and labeling with language used within the commentary text. The statistical counts offered are of course approximate and subject to individual interpretation and opinion, so please use them as a guide. They include the introduction and service management as a practice chapters, now common across all the five core publications. In the introduction chapter, about 10 pages, the same as in version 3, you'll find much improved descriptions of the purpose of the lifecycle stage being discussed, key goals and objectives, the scope of operation, and how this stage brings value to the business. The service management as a practice chapter, about 20 pages, provides a simpler explanation of services and service management. The suggested page count excludes the appendices, glossary of terms, also common across the publications, and index, numbering between 50 and 75 pages in all. Accounting for the topic bleed in the initial chapters and appendices, there are some 224 pages of reference and study material, and within these pages are some 35 new terms. Excepting most are not new to ITIL as a whole, being terms used in other core publications, their use within service transition is new, and therefore important to note, as they carry with them additional context and integration points between transition and other ITIL service lifecycle stages. Terms, ins and outs. There are a number of new terms and concepts introduced to ITIL through service transition. These include change proposal, fixed assets, metadata, and schema mapping. Out and no longer referenced are terms like activity model and asset manager. The procedural flowchart provided for managing normal changes is an example of the numerous subtle but important enhancements made within the change management process discussion. As can be seen in the comparison with the version 3 diagram, additional detail in the flowchart, and further explanations in the supporting descriptive text ease the task of adoption and adaptation into existing practices. There is a greater emphasis on explaining the elements of a configuration management system and how it supports one or more configuration management databases, including within a federated architecture. The previous emphasis on the service knowledge management system is lessened within the configuration management process discussion and re-emphasized in that on knowledge management. Similar enhancements are made to the guidance for release and deployment, with the previous diagram changed for better synchronization with the supporting descriptions. A significant addition is a detailed list in the form of a table of the key inputs and outputs to and from service transition with respect to each of the other service lifecycle stages. This is important information and is presented twice, once as part of the discussion on principles and later as a dedicated appendix. There is no immediate or long-term, come to that, impact for professionals studying for the ITIL Foundation Certificate. It's unlikely any of the adjustments made to the existing version 3 processes in 2011 will result in any other changes to foundation-level training or examination questions. The new and enhanced content, even considering the important modifications to change management, will have a minimal impact to those considering the intermediate lifecycle syllabus, as represented by comments from official sources within guidance provided to accredited training organizations regarding the syllabus. In summary, the service transition publication has undergone a minor contextual edit. As in all the core publications, a comprehensive statement of purpose and set of goals is now included in the introduction. Every diagram has been given extra treatment to ensure improved readability. Additional comprehensive guidance is provided on the concept of change models and new guidance on change proposals. A new diagram previously seen in an introductory companion publication is introduced to better explain the phases of release and deployment. What was named evaluation as a process in version 3 is now renamed the change evaluation process. And there is important clarification and additional guidance for how the change management process operates. New guidance is included to describe and differentiate asset and fixed asset management from service asset and configuration management. And there's also new guidance on implementing service transition in a virtual or cloud environment, and a substantial explanation of risk and risk management. Another important addition is a detailed table describing the inputs to and outputs from the transition stage. Once again, thank you for your interest in this presentation.